Good morning, everybody. How's it going? Good to see you. Is this the point where you usually look at the screen? Yeah, sorry. You got to look at me today. Sorry about that. It's good to be with you guys. My name is Dave, and I'm one of the pastors from our Rolling Meadows campus. Been just really excited to be together today. This was a weekend when we kind of scheduled, like, let's have our campus pastors preach this weekend, and we're always excited about that. And you got to know, John Bell really is ready for that. But he is such a faithful guy and such a committed guy. He's like, well, it's also wake-up weekend, and I'm going to be hanging out with students all weekend and probably not sleeping much. And yeah, is there somebody in the house excited about wake-up? I get the sense. Is that what I'm hearing? Yeah. And you're awake. It worked. That's awesome. And in the second row. Good luck staying awake, guys. It's great. But anyway, so John was... That's our student conference for junior high and high school students. So that started Friday night, and sleep optional ends right about now after this service. So we're very pumped about that. And as we were talking about it, I'm like, man, we'd love to, let's do this together. So I was excited to be with you guys today. You guys have an awesome staff here. I don't know if you know that or not. Hang on. I'm going to tee you up for this, all right? Not only John and Melissa serving as your campus pastor and his wife, and she's right here with all of her girls this morning. I love that. And Jordan and Roxy Donald, but also, if that weren't enough, Katie and Sally and Bridget and Emma and Bill and Amy, my goodness, what a great team. Let's thank the Lord for them. That's awesome. Yeah. Yes, yes, love it. Well, I have the privilege also of serving on staff, and better than that, I'm married to my wife, Diane. She is fantastic, and we have been married 22 years, coming up on our 23rd anniversary. In addition to God's grace in that, I'm blessed to have four daughters. So I heard someone say once, you are a minority in a sorority, and it is true. We had three of our kids go to the wake-up conference, and they all left the house. We're like, wow, it's just one daughter. Except that another small group needed a place to go, and so the eighth grade girls came and stayed at our house. So go figure. That's the way it goes. It's awesome to be with you guys today. I don't think for a second that what you need is to hear from me. I think what we all need desperately is to hear from the Lord. And I'm thankful we're in a church where God's word is the authority and where we submit to it. And that's our plan again today. Now, we've been going through the book of Mark, just Jesus, and this particular section we've subtitled All Authority, because Jesus demonstrates he has authority over everything. So we're going to be in Mark again. You can start heading towards Mark chapter 6, and we're going to actually touch on two different stories that are connected today that tell us and reveal to us Jesus' authority and Jesus' identity. He is the Son of God, okay? Jesus is the Son of God. My desire, my hope, my prayer for today is that all of us, you, me, we will listen to what God's word has to tell us about who Jesus is, to receive it, and not just to receive it, to respond to it. You know, James chapter 1 tells us, don't be merely hearers of the word, then it says deceiving yourself, but be effectual doers of the word. I don't want us to listen to a bunch of things and then be like, all right, let's go home. I want us to listen to things with the heart to say, what is my response? How should I respond to the Lord because of what he has showed us through his word? We don't come to church to hear from a person, but to hear from the Lord. We don't come primarily to see our friends, but to go with our friends to see Jesus. And we don't come here to check a box, but to draw near to the living God. And today is another opportunity for us in that. I pray we will not miss it. We're going to observe today Jesus with his disciples in a storm. We're going to observe today Jesus bringing clarity in the midst of confusion about who he really was. And we're also going to observe Jesus healing miraculously people in desperate need of healing. And I have enough faith to believe that he may want to do some of those things even today. So I want us to pray, I want us to commit this time to him, and then we're going to jump into God's word together. Even as we pray now, I just want to encourage you to let your body reflect a posture of a heart that is ready to receive. So with your hands, if you want, just even open them up in front of you. Lord, we're doing this to remind ourselves that we're here to receive, we're here to listen, we're here to yield to what you tell us. And I believe that your word, it's always right on time. It's always living and active. It always accomplishes the purpose for which it was sent. So Lord, please, again today, do that. We submit to you and to it. And we pray all this in Jesus' name. Everybody said, amen. Amen. All right. Well, last week we were in Mark chapter 6, and we had a story about what? This would be the participation part. What was the story, Jesus? What was the miracle he did in Mark chapter 6? He fed 5,000, but actually, as we learned, it wasn't probably 5,000. It was 5,000 men, and then there were women, and then there were kids. Who knows? Who knows? He fed a bunch of people with very limited resources. 2 fish, 5 loaves. Definitely not enough unless Jesus is in the equation, and then it's more than enough. And he miraculously provided what was needed. This is Jesus who has all authority. But you'll find that he's not done. He has more to accomplish. He has more on his agenda. The story is moving forward because Jesus is compelled to do the will of his Father. He's not sitting around. He is doing what the Father directs him to do. So we had this feeding of 5,000 people plus. That was a miracle. You agree? How in the world? Well, because Jesus was involved. Yes, the crowd saw it and probably had a bunch of thoughts. Maybe that was really cool. Maybe we should open an Old Country Buffet. Maybe, I don't know what they were thinking, but like, that was incredible. How did he do that? It was truly a miracle, but I'm not sure that they all really honed in on what he wanted them to see. And we're going to see that as the story goes forward today. The disciples, not only did they see it, they got to participate in it, and they got to go home with a souvenir basket of bread. Unbelievable, right? 12 baskets of bread. Here, guys, take this with you. They got to see the whole thing up close and personal. And Jesus, immediately following that story, he's back on mission. I have things to do that are the will of my Father. I have a timeline that is determined by my Heavenly Father, and I'm on it. We're going to look at Mark. Mark. We're going to be in Mark chapter 6, verse 45. And what is the first word that your Bible says in Matthew? I got to stop saying that. Mark 6, 45. What's the first word? Immediately. Immediately. Can I just say one thing about immediately? 41 times in the book of Mark. Isn't that interesting? Immediately. 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 Why? Because there's a lot going on because Jesus is so laser focused on the mission his Father has given, and he is going to the next immediately, immediately, immediately. And it moves the story forward continually through the book of Mark. You know, Jesus didn't ponder things in his mind and worship God in his thoughts. He wouldn't merely do that. A servant shouldn't do that. A servant needs to act. A servant needs to respond. When the instructions are clear, I will do what my Lord has told me to do. Jesus didn't just take action of his own accord, nor did he elevate himself above others. He was a lowly, humble servant, and he was submitted to his Heavenly Father. Within that, he had urgency because his Father had things he wanted accomplished and things revealed. We're going to be reminded today that Jesus was compelled to do the will of his Father, and in that, he was revealing who he really was to all those who are around him. So, I know you. I don't know the Aurora campus that well, but I know our people, and you want to fill in some blanks, right? Is it killing you that we haven't hit a blank yet? It's time. It's time. Point one, here we go, is this. I am sovereign over your storm. Okay, that's our first point today. I am sovereign over your storm, obviously referring to Jesus. He presses ahead and hears this word immediately as we start reading in verse 45. Look at verse 45 of Mark chapter 6. Immediately he made his disciples get into the boat and go before him to the other side, to Bethsaida, while he dismissed the crowd. And after he had taken leave of them, he went up on the mountain to pray. And when evening came, the boat was out on the sea, and he was alone on the land. And he saw that they were making headway painfully, for the wind was against them. And about the fourth watch of the night, he came to them, walking on the sea. He meant to pass them by, but when they saw him walking on the sea, they thought it was a ghost, and they cried out, for they all saw him and were terrified. But immediately he spoke to them and said, "Take heart. It is I. Do not Be afraid. Okay, we're going to pause right there. Now, I just want to make a couple of observations about what I see when I read those verses. First of all, I see Jesus is leading. Do you see that? First of all, immediately, when is it happening? Right now. It's happening right now. Immediately. And what does he do? He tells them, he made his disciples get in the boat. But Lord, there's a big crowd. They seem like they might be open to hearing some more teachings. Maybe you could do that bread thing for dinner again. You know, I don't know what they were thinking, but he said, guys, get in the boat. Well, but how are you going to interact with all the people, and are you going to send them home? Get in the boat. He's leading his disciples. He's telling them what's going on. I want you to go to the other side, to Bethsaida. I will dismiss the crowd. Jesus, you want us to go? This seems like it's all happening. I want you to go. Take the bread baskets with you. Throw them in the boat. It doesn't actually say that. I just wonder. He has all authority. Jesus has all authority, and you can see it in the way he interacts with his followers and those who don't even know him. He has authority over creation. He has authority over sickness. These are reviews of things we've already seen in our study of Mark. He has power and authority over demons, over all of nature, over everything. Jesus has all authority. And so what does he do? He sends his disciples to the boat. Go before me to Bethsaida. He dismissed the crowd. Why did he do that? What was happening there? Interestingly, the book of John, a parallel passage to this that tells this story. In John 6:15, it says, they, the crowd, were about to come and take him by force to make him king. So he's like, I know what's going on here. They're amazed. They're seeing prophecies fulfilled. They're thinking, this is our ticket. He's the new ruler. Let's get him in charge. And he's like, no, that was not the will of my Father, and that's not the way he wanted it done. So he dismisses them. He puts that aside. That's not what my Father has. So he goes up on the mountain alone. He's praying. I love that you see Jesus repeatedly in the Gospels going to be with his Father, going to pray. I need connection, Jesus thought, and direction from my Father. I need to be refueled and refocused. It's so instructive for us. My calendar is full. I'm very blessed. I'm never bored. But you can go next thing, next thing, next thing, next thing, next thing, and you're like, are we connecting with our Heavenly Father? Because that's what we're called to do. That's what Jesus modeled for us right here. He went up on the mountain to pray. Look at verse 47. And when evening came, the boat was out on the sea, and he was alone on the land. And he saw that they were making headway painfully, for the wind was against them. So they're in this boat, right? And they're not actually going that. Don't think like Lake Michigan and it's going to take forever. This is like a 3 or 4 mile little stint straight across. It's quite likely he could see them from where he was the whole time. Making headway painfully. I hate that sentence. Anybody else with me? I'm tired thinking about it. I live just north of Interstate 90 on Randall Road. So I drove Randall Road down to here this morning. Yeah. Anybody know how many stoplights that is? Some of you are like, I do it every day. Pastor John told me there's 50. Is that correct? 50 from the Elgin campus to here, and I'm a little bit north of that. So I'm going to go with 54, 55 stoplights this morning. What percentage of those do you think were red? What percentage needed to be red on a Sunday morning? Okay, we'll move on. But I don't like to make headway painfully. That feels wearisome. That feels exhausting. That feels discouraging. And this is exactly what the disciples were experiencing. Maybe not the stoplight part. They were making headway painfully. It wasn't a failure to act. It was the circumstances were such that progress could not be made. Now look at verse 48. He saw that they were making headway painfully, for the wind was against them. All right, let's make this personal for a second. They had a real wind and a real boat on a real lake pushing against them. But you and I have things that we face too, that are headwinds, that are storms, that are trials, that are challenges. And it's instructive for us to think about where God is in the midst of my struggles, in the midst of my storms. There's sweat and tears and extreme effort and darkness and how long and why are we and where is Jesus might all be things that the disciples were thinking at that time. Can I just review a little bit of truth about storms? Let me just give you a couple things. You might find yourself in here somewhere. Let's just set aside the main point of what we're doing. I just want to say this for a second. Some storms are just consequences, okay? You're like, man, I wish I would have paid my electric bill the last 3 months so they didn't have to shut it off. I'm like, well, why didn't you pay your electric bill? Well, because I bought a boat and I didn't have enough money to pay my electric bill. Okay, well, enjoy the boat, but that's a consequence, okay? You did, a consequence is I put myself here. And we've all done this. We've all made foolish decisions. We've all made sinful decisions. And sometimes what we experience as a storm is like, I actually put myself in that spot, okay? That's a little different than what we're reading today. Here's another thing. Other storms are trials, flat out. God put me here. And I know in Western culture in 2020, that's not always a very popular message. You're like, I thought he wanted me happy. I thought he wanted me healthy. I thought I was going to get richer and everything got better when I followed Jesus. I don't read that in the Bible. I don't. Sometimes he puts us directly in the trial, in the storm. Here's another thought about storms. I can complicate the storms by responding foolishly. You ever been in that spot? Yeah, it's a hard circumstance, but all of a sudden you're thinking crazy and you're acting crazy and it is getting worse and worse and worse. Maybe the disciples felt like, I'm just jumping in. Well, we don't read that they did. Well, actually, Peter at one point, but that's a different part of the story. You can do crazy things, foolish things that make your storms exponentially worse. We say sometimes in our counseling ministry, don't trouble your troubles. The trouble's inevitable. How you respond to it is really, really important. So another thing about storms, storms are promised for all followers of Jesus, okay? Storms are promised for all followers of Jesus. Anybody have, no shaming, I'm not against you if you have this. Anybody have like a t-shirt or a coffee mug or a print on your wall that has scripture on it? I do. I have all those things. Okay, so one I've never seen is John 16:33, which says, in this world, you will have tribulations. I don't know if I'm shopping in the wrong place or what, but I don't find that t-shirt anywhere. I haven't seen it on any coffee mugs. Yeah, we're going to have trouble. But that is as much a promise of God's word as all those other wonderful promises are too. And storms are promised to the followers of Jesus Christ. And for these men, they were not off the path of what the Lord had for them. They were directly in the path of obedience and headed into a storm. Last thing, God is sovereign over the details of your storm. He is sovereign over the details of your storm, and he wants you to see him for truly who he truly is. Why, Lord? Why the pain? Why the stress? Why the heartache? Because I want to show you something. Better than that, I want to show you someone. I want to show you my son, Jesus Christ, and all he is and who he has shown himself to be. Now, some storms are sudden and shocking. You ever had one of those? We kind of read about one of those earlier in Mark, right? The storm came out of nowhere, and they're like, we're terrified. We're going to die. They didn't see that coming. One of our staff in Rolling Meadows this week, they were in the car with he and his wife and their young daughter, and they got just T-boned. Didn't see it coming, and wow, I looked at the picture, and they all walked away from the car, and they were fine. Thank you, Lord. Doesn't always end like that. But anyway, some storms are sudden and shocking, and they're memorable for a lifetime. I think this kind of storm that's in here is long and wearisome and feels like it's never going to end. And sometimes you have storms like that. I don't see a day when this could be over. I don't see a time when the wind is going to calm down. I can't imagine going forward anymore. I'm exhausted. I don't know what to do. I want to encourage you today that we worship and serve a God who is sovereign over your storm. Interestingly, when did the disciples get in the boat? Did you see that? They got in the boat, let's see, verse 47, and when what? when evening came. So let's go with what, 6 o'clock? Is that when evening comes, 6 p.m.? All right. Now, looking ahead, they're out in the wind. They're making headway painfully. And verse 48, about the fourth watch of the night. When is the fourth watch of the night? That's about when all the students that wake up think about going to bed, okay? That's between 3 a.m. and 6 a.m. They may or may not do it, but that's the time you start thinking about it. And the fourth watch of the night, think with me. You got in the boat at evening, 6, 7. Now it is past midnight, past 1, 2, past 3. You're looking at maybe 9 hours rowing into the wind. No, thank you. Might be a good fitness class, but I'm out. I don't want to do it. That's what's going on here. And can I just tell you, God is sovereign over their storm. He set them into it. He knows where they are. He knows they're struggling. What does he do? He's praying. He's watching. And now he sees it's time to step in. By the way, as a parent, maybe you've been in this spot, I have a vivid memory of one of my kids at swimming lessons. And it wasn't going great. And a lot of water was going in where it shouldn't. And eyes were watering and coughing. And I remember her looking at me and be just like, "Dad, save me from this place." And I was like, "It's okay, honey. This is good. We're going to learn some stuff here." That was not a very convincing speech, but we did it. And she persevered. And guess what? Today she can swim. And she can get counseling for all the rest of it. So I'm just kidding. Just kidding. There's times as a parent when you're like, the most important thing is not the absence of struggle. The most important thing is that they would learn something. And in this case, learn something about who God is and who his son Jesus Christ is. If you are in a storm, I am so weary. I can't imagine another hour. When is daylight? How long can this? Please don't waste it. It can be the time when God wants to teach you who he is like you've never seen it before. It can be the time he wants to show you something about himself that you haven't fully understood till now. The struggle has a purpose. The struggle has a purpose, and he wants to show you who he is. Jesus, the Son of God. Last night, we had church on our Rolling Meadows campus, and I met a man I'd never met before. I'm going to call him Bill. And Bill told me a story about how he's got really bad test results and he's got problems internally and he's had surgeries and he's got treatments and he didn't look good. He has been through it. And I just said to Bill, I said, "Bill, I don't know where you are with the Lord, but I really believe that God is gracious to us to allow us to at times struggle to understand who he really is." And in the scope of eternity, it was a very gracious thing that our God would allow us to suffer, allow us to struggle, allow us to go through a storm if it would open our eyes and turn our hearts to respond to Jesus as our Savior, as our Lord. What a gracious thing that God would do that for us. The struggle has a purpose. The storm is on God's agenda of revealing to you who he really is. God wants you to know him and wants you to worship him in your storm. In our weaknesses, God's strength is more evident, and we can recognize that he truly is God and I truly am not. And we get the opportunity to honor him in worship and word and actions. Another person from the campus, Meadows, last night, she's recently been diagnosed with cancer, and it's not good. It's a bad report. And she's a business owner, and she said to me last night, she goes, "This week I had the opportunity to teach my staff how to pray." I was like, "Really?" She said, "Well, they wanted to pray for me." And so I got God's word, and I thought, well, here's what he says about how to pray. I'm like, "Are you kidding me? I could think of 10 things I'd say before I'd say that when I'm dealing with that." But she saw this as an opportunity to worship and serve her God in the midst of a storm she would never choose. Jesus, don't miss this. Jesus sent them into the waves. "Well, it's getting hard. This can't be God's plan for me. This is too hard." I've had that thought a couple times. They're seemingly by themselves, but he was near. He was watching. He is praying. And more than wanting their short-term comfort, he wanted them to know his true identity. And that's why I love what he says in verse 50. "Take heart, it is I. Do not be afraid. God is sovereign over your storm. He is in control. He is ruling over our storms. When we're at the end of the message, not now, when we're at the end of the message today, we're going to give you an opportunity just to respond to the Lord. I don't want to go to church where everybody puts on a smiley face and, how are you? Great. How are you? Great. How are you? Really? Y'all are great? Like, God is great, but sometimes things are hard. And maybe you're at a point you're like, I'm in that storm. I can't row much farther. I'm so weary. And I just want to encourage you that you can come to the Lord because he says, it's I. Don't be anxious. Don't fear. And we're going to give an opportunity even before we're done today just to pray. And you might want to respond to the Lord and bring that to him if you feel like you're in a storm today. All right, second point. Keep moving immediately through this. Number two, I am clarity in your confusion. That's the second point. I am clarity in your confusion. Let's look at verse 51 and 52. And he got into the boat. Did he climb over the baskets of bread? I don't know. I'm kind of making it up. He got into the boat with them, and the wind ceased. And they were utterly astounded, for they did not understand about the loaves, but their hearts were hardened. Now, let's just back up. What's the order of what's happening here? They're against the wind. They're battling the waves. Jesus is near, walking. Now, by the way, what does it say about him? It says, when they saw, verse 40, let's go with 48. About the fourth watch of the night, he came to them walking on the sea. Wow. And he meant to pass them by. I think that's hilarious. What? Here's what I think is actually going on there. I think what is happening is they thought he meant to pass them by, but what he meant to do was come near them. So they knew he was there. But that's how they perceived it. And when they saw him walking on the sea, they thought it was a ghost and they cried out. So they cry out in fear. Why? Where's this fear come from, by the way? These are fishermen. They're familiar with boats. They're familiar with night. They're familiar with waves. What were they afraid of? Well, they're afraid because they didn't understand who Jesus was, and they thought he was not who he was. They thought he was a ghost. So they were terrified. They're yelling out in fear. So Jesus speaks to them. He gets in the boat, and the winds cease. See, they had a mistaken identity thing going on with Jesus right there. Oh, no, it's a ghost. Oh, it's Jesus. But I don't think they totally got it even yet. And we're like that sometimes, right? We're just confused. I don't think I've never really seen him for who he is. Or maybe I have, but I have this like amnesia thing going on about Jesus' identity. And I could pass the test on what's true if you put it in front of me. But when it comes to actually trusting him and actually walking with him through the trial, I get a little foggy. And I think we're all like that. He is clarity in our confusion. And they were astounded. Now, it's interesting. It says, verse 52, for they did not understand about the loaves. Well, what? Why are we coming back to the loaves? Well, remember now, immediately, this was not like 4 days later. This was 9 to 12-ish hours after the loaves happened. Maybe they're sitting in the boat. I don't know. Maybe they're chomping on one in the middle of the night. I'm not sure what happened. But they didn't understand what Jesus was really showing them. It's not about the bread. It's not about the fish. It's about my identity. I am God's son. I am in charge, and I am here with you. Jesus was their friend and teacher. He was the miracle worker. He was healing and feeding, but most of all, Jesus is the Son of God, and that is the point of these passages. He's revealing himself. But did they get it? Do you think they got it? I don't think they got it, because 52 says, verse 52, they did not understand about the loaves, but their hearts were hardened. What is a hardened heart? A hardened heart is dull. A hardened heart is calloused. A hardened heart is slow to understand, not perceiving what's actually true, unbelieving, sometimes even resistant or cold. Lord, help us not to have a hardened heart. That's an awful thing. And we need so much to have God's perspective that this would not happen to us. How does a calloused heart develop? Let me ask you that. Here's a couple of ways it develops. We lose sight of what God has done in your life. Have you ever had this problem? Some of you have walked, I know some of you, you've walked with the Lord for decades. And we get a little bit down the road and you forget the miracle of salvation. I cannot believe that God gave his son to pay for my sins, that I could be forgiven, that I could be adopted, that I could have eternal life. That's enough right there. Just dwell on that. But I lose sight of it. I lose sight of what God has done, and it can cause a calloused heart. Here's a second thing. I lose sight of the importance of other believers in my life. You know what? I have the Lord and his son Jesus and the Holy Spirit and the Bible, and I'm good. I don't need, I mean, y'all are nice, but no thanks. That's an awful mistake, because God tells us that a key component of what he calls us to do is to be brothers and sisters to each other. He says in Hebrews 10, don't forsake the assembling together as is the habit of some, but all the more as you see the day drawing near. And we're supposed to consider how to stir one another up to love and good deeds. And so callousness can come because I have forgotten the importance of biblical community and church family. It can come because I've lost sight of the Holy Spirit's promptings in my life. If the Holy Spirit is prompting you to do something that is consistent with God's word, to obey him, to do something that God has you on mission for, the correct answer is yes. Yes, I will, Lord. The correct timing is, you want to guess? Immediately. Now. Now. If the Holy Spirit's prompting, do it now. And but we can lose this because I'm not listening, because I'm not yielding, because I'm not sensitive to what the Lord is leading. And then one more. How does a callus develop on your heart? You lose sight of God's word shaping your life. I talk to a lot of people who are like, just pray that I'd have more faith, Dave. I mean, I need more faith. I believe it's all true, but I just need more faith. Okay, I will pray if you will do your part. And Romans 10:17 says this, faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of Christ. That's Romans 10:17. If you feel your faith is weak, I would just ask, what are you feeding it? Are you feeding it with what's true? Or are you allowing the world to fill your mind and your heart with all kinds of other messages? Now, by the way, one of the great ministries that the Lord's entrusted to us as a church is a ministry called Hope Groups. And Hope Groups is perfect if you find yourself in a place like this. I feel distant from the Lord. I am going through a struggle. I don't know that I can do this. I need more support of brothers and sisters in Christ. My goodness. I would just commend that to you. And aren't you doing it here in Aurora, John? Yeah, and it starts when? This Thursday. That's incredible. Thank you for planning so well. So you're saying somebody could come to Hope Groups this week if they needed to. Thank you. What a great pastor you are. Guys, there's hope in Jesus. Let's protect ourselves and be cautious of a calloused heart, a hardened heart. How do I develop a calloused heart? Well, I think coming close to what's true but not surrendering to it is very dangerous. I like when those guys talk about the Bible. That's nice. That's awful if you will not surrender to it, okay? If I will surrender to the Lord, he gives me a tender heart, a teachable heart, and it's for him. So I just want to ask you this. What do you want most in the storm? Let's just cut to the chase here. What do you want most? Do you just want to minimize the confusion? You know what? It's all just so messed up in my mind. Can we just cut through it so I don't have to worry about all that? Or do you want to know the clarity of Jesus Christ as Lord? Okay, one is a short-term peace, calm, whatever. The other is a lasting reality, a Savior, a Lord, now and for eternity. Don't settle for merely a little peace in my thinking. I need the clarity of Jesus Christ as Lord. Or what do you want in your storm? Do you just want to escape the struggle? I just want out. I was texting with a friend yesterday. You can pray for them. It was not good. At the end of the day, they just want to run. They just want to run. Or do I want to worship and serve our God and his son, Jesus Christ, who's our sustainer? Lord, you're enough. I'm going to stay in because you're enough. Do you want just to be saved from the storm? These waves, I hate these waves. I'm never going in a boat again. Or I want to know and worship the Savior who sent the storm. I want to know him in my life. And I just simply would ask you this. Do you have clarity of who Jesus Christ is? This is the whole point of this passage, and it's much of what he's doing through the book of Mark. Jesus is God's Son. He is the Savior. He came to pay the price we could never pay. He came to pay the price for my sins and for your sins. And then he offers it to you like a gift, and he says, will you receive it? And if you've never received it, my goodness, why not today? Lord, I could be forgiven. Lord, I could belong to you. Lord, I could move from death to life. More, I could have a promise and a future. I could be connected to you and to your church family. It's beautiful. Do you have clarity on who he is? Maybe you've had that clarity and you've drifted from it. My heart is a bit cold. My heart is a bit hard. Today's the day to address that. And like I said, in a moment, we're going to pray. And if you're like, oh, Lord, tenderize my heart. I want to hear from you. I don't want to be calloused. I want to understand. Today would be a great day to respond to him. I am sovereign over your storm. I am clarity in your confusion. And then just this last point, I am hope for your healing. Wow, think about this. Listen to this. Do you believe God's word is true? I do too. And it blows me away. Listen to what we're about to read in verse 53. When they had crossed over, they came to the land at Gennesaret and moored to the shore. Okay, just think with me for a second. 5,000 people, no bread, no food. Miracle. God takes a little bit that's there. He meets the needs. He puts them in a boat. Let's go. Actually, I'm not going. You're going. He sends them off in the boat. They face adversity, wind against them all night till early in the morning. They think they see a ghost. Oh, no, it's Jesus. Awesome. And then they get back to shore after he calms the waves. What are you ready for now? A nap. Me too, a nap. Maybe some more of the bread. Can he make more? I don't know how that works. But what happened? They moored to the shore, verse 54, and when they got out of the boat, the people, how did they do it? Immediately recognized him and ran about the whole region and began to bring the sick people on their beds to wherever they heard he was. Jesus was on a mission directed by his Father, and people, the word was getting out. He is healing people. He's casting out demons. He's doing miracles. He's here. He just landed on the shore. Go get the sick people. Go get cousin Larry. Bring him over here. Go get your mom. Bring him over here. Jesus is here. He's the healer. What a reputation. They got it. They got it. Wherever he came, in villages, cities, or countrysides, they laid the sick in the marketplaces, and they implored him that they might touch even the fringe of his garment. That's beautiful. And what does it say? And as many as touched it were made well. This is Jesus, all authority. This is Jesus, all power. He's right there. They're imploring him. If we could just get close to Jesus, let's go get the people who are sick. Pastor John said as he prayed earlier, Jesus didn't come for the healthy people. He came for the sick people. Let's go get the people who are sick, who need healing. Let's bring them to Jesus. Maybe it's a physical healing. I believe God heals. I've watched it. Maybe it's an emotional healing. Maybe it's a relational or a family healing. How can we find hope for our healing? You'll find it in Jesus. And as simply as I can say it, run to him and implore him and ask him to heal. I was really stirred by Tony Evans, a pastor in Dallas. His wife recently died. And Tony's son, whose mom had died, at the service, the funeral service, said, I came to an understanding that either God was going to heal her completely or he was going to heal her completely. And I think sometimes we don't understand that God has an economy that we don't always work with. But our God and his son, Jesus Christ, offers hope because he's able to heal. And I believe he could do it today, and I know he will do it in eternity if we draw near to him. He is hope for our healing. And I would just simply ask you this. Are you, that's me. I'm in need of healing today. I am. I don't see a way forward. I can't see that situation mended. The doctor says, I don't know what the circumstances might be, but we're going to give an opportunity right now. And I want you, if the Lord is stirring in you, to respond to him. And if you're like, I am that person in the storm, I'm so weary of it. But Lord, I don't want to just escape it. I want to learn what you want me to learn. I want to know you for who you are. Help me, Lord, to learn what you want me to learn. If that's you, my goodness, give it to the Lord today. We're going to open up the front of the church, and you're welcome to come and just come forward and kneel and pray. Maybe you're like, I'm that confusion, that hard heart thing. I know what's true, but I've been confused. I've been wandering away. Lord, bring me the clarity of who you are. Jesus, it is I, he says. Or maybe you're at a spot like, Lord, would you intervene? Would you heal? Would you heal this, the thing that only you could do? And scripture says that we can come, because of Jesus Christ, we can come boldly before the throne of grace with confidence to receive mercy and grace to help us in our time of need. And if you feel that today, you're like, Lord, I need you so desperately. Let's go to him. Let's go to him. We're going to open up the front. The worship team's going to lead us. We're going to sing a little bit, and then I'm going to pray together. So you can come right now if that's on your heart. Why don't you come up, and we'll pray in just a moment.